Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank Professor Reda Kaman and the conference board for inviting me. Actually, septoplasty is a very old surgery. It is dating since the time of Pharaohs. There is a papyrus, actually a textbook, describing the septoplasty and dating 5,000 years ago. The modern septoplasty started with Freer and Killian, who introduced the submucous resection, and then came Metzenbaum, who introduced the swinging door technique, and finally Kotel introduced the hemitransfection and conservative septal resection. This is history. We can't rely on it now in the era of evidence-based medicine. We are obliged to give evidence that every surgery we are doing provide a valued outcome for the patient and for the society, and it is weighed against its cost. And we should provide high level of evidence, because the evidence are in different levels. The highest level of evidence is from randomized controlled trial, and the lowest level of evidence, level 5, is from the case report and the expert opinion. The problem is the randomized controlled trials are very difficult to design. It is costly, and the surgeon doesn't have enough time to do it. So most of our surgery in our specialty and other specialties does not rely on high quality evidence of effectiveness. The septoplasty can be cost effective, because if the nasal obstruction is affecting about 25% of the population, the septal deviations affect about 90% of the population, and the cost of treatment of the nasal obstruction is about three times the cost of septoplasty every year, according to figures from the UK. But the problem is nasal obstruction doesn't include septal deviation only. There is mucosal dysregulation, the inspiratory collapse of the ala, the psychological factor, and some neurologic factor. And similarly, on the other side, there is no consensus on the classification of septoplasty, which septal deviation produces which type of nasal obstruction. In spite of that, septoplasty remains one of the most done surgery. It is the third most common surgery in otolaryngology, head and neck surgery, and the most common in adults. But with the presence of septal deviation, it is always overestimated as a cause of nasal obstruction, and the mucosal disease is underestimated. And not every nasal obstruction with septal deviation is due to the septal deviation. And the question which is now asked everywhere, does straightening the septum benefit the patient? And if so, which patient will benefit most? One research team advocated that the more the patient is young, he will get benefit from the septoplasty. This remained to be proved upon a high level of evidence. The problem to assess the septoplasty is difficult, because the pathology for which we are doing the septoplasty is the quality of life, which is difficult to assess. It is assessed only by subjective questionnaires to the patient, and the postoperative effect is difficult also to quantify. Even with the objective methods like the rhinomanometry, many authors are not agreeing that it parallels the complaint of the patient. So there is a globally acknowledged evidence gap on the effectiveness of septoplasty. It started 10 years ago in the UK, and the ENT UK noticed that many hospital administrations are abolishing or severely restricting septoplasty due to a question about its effectiveness. The American Academy of Otolaryngology, Head and Neck Surgery in 2015 said that there is no clinical evidence to issue guidelines for septoplasty, and they called for further research and issued issued clinical consensus statement. The clinical consensus statement is not a guideline. It is far from being a guideline. It is an expert opinion, which is level 5 evidence. The German Society of Otolaryngology Head and Neck Surgery said last year that the indication for septoplasty in cases of chronic rhinosinusitis and bronchial asthma and obstructive sleep apnea should be redefined. So we searched the literature for on PubMed, Cochrane, and the Egyptian Knowledge Bank, which includes Ovid and Science Direct, for any randomized controlled trial on septoplasty in the adult population in the last 10 years, either in English language or in other language. Till July 2019, there was no single randomized controlled trial on effectiveness of septoplasty in nasal obstruction in the treatment of headache, sinusitis, epistaxis, obstructive sleep apnea, or anosmia or hyposmia. There was only observational studies comparing the preoperative and postoperative quality of life or nasal patency. This observational study carry a high risk of bias. The positive effect can be possible to be from other factors at the natural course of the disease, and the patient benefit from septoplasty based on observational studies are not certain. The only one randomized controlled trial on effectiveness of septoplasty in management of nasal obstruction appeared last year in The Lancet, a very prestigious journal with an impact factor of about 60. It was a multicentric done in 18 centers in the Netherlands and including 200 patients, divided in two arms. One arm got a surgery and the other arm got a medical treatment, and the patients were allocated randomly in both groups. What was the result? The result was that upon subjective assessment of the nasal obstruction, the septoplasty arm did better. And upon objective results by rhinomanometry, better also results with the septoplasty, and this better results was sustained for 2 years of follow-up. The team concluded that septoplasty is more effective than non-surgical management for nasal obstruction in adults with deviated septum, and the effect is sustained for up to 2 years. But in the same study, 70% of the patients who got medical treatment during 2 years were not in need of doing septoplasty. This is for nasal obstruction. What about of the effect of septoplasty in treatment of headache? There is no randomized controlled trial on this question, and there is no consensus, even from the expert opinion from the American Academy of Otolaryngology, that septoplasty reduces facial pain caused by intranasal contact point, what is called the rhinogenic headache. For the treatment of sinusitis, there is no randomized controlled trial, and the consensus from the American Academy said that septoplasty can improve the outcome of sinus surgery when the septum is in contact with the middle turbinate and is obstructing the ostomiator complex, and it can facilitate also the local therapy after surgery. For the treatment of epistaxis, the consensus from the American Academy said it may be useful in managing epistaxis. For the obstructive sleep apnea, there is no consensus that the septoplasty will benefit the obstructive sleep apnea patient or even the snoring patient. The only benefit from the septoplasty in OSA is that it can improve the tolerance of the CPAP. For anosmia or hyposmia, the consensus from the American Academy said the effect of septoplasty on the hyposmia is unpredictable. It may exaggerate it or it may cure it. So in conclusion, septoplasty is a common surgery for nasal obstruction, but the current literature is on its effectiveness is scarce and inconclusive. It is cost-effective, but we need further research for the effectiveness in clinical practice, and the good this research should yield good quality or high-quality evidences. There is only one randomized controlled trial given high level of evidence that septoplasty can treat the nasal obstruction in adults. This information can provide us with guidelines In this year, another trial started in the UK, and more trials, more randomized controlled trials are needed for the clinical practice, to guide the clinical practice in the point of septoplasty. Thank you very much.